Link TV, connecting you to the world. Link TV is viewer supported. Watch more at linktv.org.
Link TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Israeli settlements occupy more than 40% of the West Bank. VP Biden tries to mediate between Alawi and Maliki. And building a mosque in France sparks controversy. Mosaic World News from the Middle East begins now.
The Israeli human rights group B'Tselem revealed in a report that Israeli settlers and their organizations now control 42% of the West Bank, in addition to the Palestinian land that has been confiscated.
This report was published as U.S. President Barack Obama is set to meet with Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu in Washington today. The two will discuss the phase after the partial settlement freeze ends. Israel says it is complying with this partial settlement freeze.
من أجل ما يسمى بناء إسرائيل الكبرى بكل ما للمصطلح من معنى ودلالة جغرافية أو سياسية.
In order to build the so-called Greater Israel, with all of its geographic, political, and strategic implications, the Israeli strategy in Palestine has been and still is represented in emptying the land of its owners and replacing them with settlers. The West Bank covers 5,760 square kilometers of the historically Palestinian territory. 42% of this land is occupied by Israeli settlements. This outrageous number was revealed in a report by the Israeli human rights organization B'Tselem, which indicates that the number of settlements in the West Bank has reached 121. It also indicates that the number of settlements in the region has tripled since the end of 1993. According to the report, by the end of 2009, the number of settlers was estimated at 235,000. Today, there are more than 300,000 settlers. The organization also points to the presence of around 100 settlement centers that are not licensed by the Israeli government. Perhaps the title of the report indicates that the Israeli policy on settlements in the West Bank is to continue their construction at any cost and by any means.
ولعل ما يتوقف عنده في التقرير عنوانه الذي أشار إلى أن سياسة إسرائيل الاستيطانية في الضفة الغربية.
According to the report, the Israeli officials responsible for the settlements dealt with international law, local legislation, and Israeli military orders and laws with a derisive, even criminal attitude in order to seize that land. This report is published as the U.S. President is about to meet with the Israeli Prime Minister in several hours. It is likely that the topic of settlement construction in the West Bank will be the focus of the meeting.
الإسرائيلي خلال ساعات والذي يرجح أن تكون مسألة البناء الاستيطاني في الضفة الغربية في محوره.
Political observers expect Obama to request his guests to extend the suspension on settlement construction until at least the end of this year on the grounds that it will convince the Palestinians to move towards direct negotiations. This suggestion will be difficult for Netanyahu to respond to, since he pledged to approve the resumption of settlement construction right after the end of its suspension this coming September. Aside from the proactive reports on what may happen during the Obama-Netanyahu meeting, an Israeli newspaper revealed that there are plans to build 2,700 new settlement units in the West Bank immediately after the end of the so-called freeze.
The Public Committee Against Torture in Israel and the Legal Center for Arab Minority Rights in Israel released a joint report accusing the Israeli army of using Palestinians as human shields during the latest war on Gaza.
The report includes testimonies by Palestinians who were tortured and forced to enter homes before they were raided. Elias Karam has more details about the report and the eyewitness testimonies.
For three consecutive days, the hands of Abd Rabbu and his family members were handcuffed. Israeli soldiers took them from one home to the next in the town of Beit Lahia in northern Gaza. They were used by the Israeli forces as human shields as they were raiding homes in that town during the war on Gaza.
خلال الحرب على غزة.
They do not directly enter Palestinian homes. First, they would order a Palestinian acting as a human shield to enter the home and open the door for them. If no one was inside, then the Palestinian would come outside and say that there were no people inside. If people were inside, he would tell those inside that the soldiers want to enter the home. Since they don't trust the Palestinian, after he would leave the home, they would let a dog with cameras and equipment mounted on his body enter the home. Then the soldier would give the dog commands through a microphone while they were outside. The dog is sent to Palestinian homes after having used a Palestinian as a human shield first. Israeli soldiers did not enter Palestinian homes without inspecting what was inside by using dogs and human shields.
This testimony is one of the dozens mentioned in the joint report by the Public Committee Against Torture in Israel and the Legal Center for Arab Minority Rights. In some cases, even children were used as human shields to inspect sites suspected by the Israeli soldiers of being hideouts for Palestinian resistance members, or if they felt that their lives were in danger. Israeli soldiers used to order Palestinians to enter homes before they are even inspected by dogs, as if the life of a dog is more valuable than the life of a human. The report also includes testimonies saying that the Israeli soldiers beat Palestinians, and in some cases they even urinated on them. The soldiers also imprisoned Palestinians in underground holes for many days in open fields without food and water, and they were not even allowed to use the restroom.
In some cases, detainees were tortured, and this is dangerous. Israel did not treat the Palestinians as war prisoners. Rather, it created a new legal category for them called illegal detainees, which enabled Israel to violate their human rights and violate international law.
These horrifying stories emerged from behind the rubble that was left behind by Israeli war machines during the 23 days of war on Gaza. There are also other stories about Israeli soldiers deliberately killing unarmed civilians, not to mention the random bombardment of private property, residential homes, and the infrastructure. These testimonies support accusations that Israel committed human rights violations during the war on Gaza. According to the Goldstone report, these violations can be categorized as war crimes and crimes against humanity. Elias Karam, Al Jazeera, West Jerusalem.
Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu leaves for Washington later this evening and is scheduled to meet tomorrow in the White House with U.S. President Barack Obama. Just hours before Netanyahu's departure, Defense Minister Ehud Barak met in Jerusalem with PA Prime Minister Salam Fayyad. Bringing us up to date is IBA's diplomatic correspondent, Leah Zinter. Good evening, Leah.
Yes, hi, Yohanan. Well, you know, some would say that the direct talks between Israel and the Palestinians actually resumed this afternoon with the first public meeting in 2 months between Barak and Fayyad. And as you hinted, Yohanan, the timing was far from coincidental. The Palestinians have been carefully polishing their image as peacemakers in the run-up to the Netanyahu-Obama summit. And Israel, it must be said, is equally anxious to engage in confidence-building measures ahead of that summit. In today's meeting, Barak informed Fayyad of details of the lifting of the land blockade on Gaza and other steps to ease the lives of Palestinians. And as to the summit itself, the Prime Minister, we're told, need not fear a repetition of his last disastrous and humiliating White House encounter with President Obama. The U.S. administration will go out of its way to give Netanyahu a welcome worthy of a close ally, hosting him this time at Blair House and arranging the prized photo opportunity and joint press conference with the President. Behind the scenes, senior aides to Netanyahu and Obama have been working furiously on what Netanyahu has been saying is at the heart of the summit, apart, of course, from Iran, the transition to direct talks with the Palestinians. Everyone in Washington and Jerusalem knows that the Palestinians will not agree to direct talks if the settlement freeze is lifted on September 26. And if it isn't lifted, Netanyahu has no government. But we are assured there will be no public disagreement in this summit. Instead, diplomatic sources are saying there may be an understanding in the works that may not be made public at this time. And it's this. After September 26, construction would resume in the settlements, but discreetly and quietly, it would resume only in the major settlement blocks that are expected to remain part of Israel in a final status agreement. President Shimon Peres, by the way, with whom Netanyahu consulted this afternoon, urged the Prime Minister to be proactive and to initiate a peace plan of his own. But most of Netanyahu's government will resist that and will insist on a full resumption of construction in the settlements in statements such as these. Let's hear them.
The position of the Israeli government is very clear, including the position of the prime minister. The freeze was supposed to last 10 months. 10 months will be over on September 26th. This is our position. There will be no additional freeze on the Jewish communities in Judea and Samaria.
There's no room for any further freeze. The current freeze has not brought anything, and there was not even a single progress by the Palestinians following the freeze.
Okay, Yochanan, the White House summit sets for 6 p.m. our time tomorrow evening. Back to you, Yochanan.
Today marks the ninth day of the 12-day Freedom March for Gilad Shalit. Thousands of supporters joined the Shalit family in Tel Aviv to implore the Israeli government to do all it can to bring back the kidnapped soldier. IBA's Ariel Reshef has more.
Thousands of demonstrators gathered outside the North Tel Aviv home of Defense Minister Ehud Barak today to urge immediate action to free captive soldier Gilad Shalit. March participants were surprised when Nili Priel, the wife of the defense minister, joined the rally to express her solidarity. Later, the throngs of protesters made their way to central Tel Aviv, where a mass rally took place in Rabin Square. The crowd carried banners with the slogans, "If it were up to us, you would already be back," "Our march, your pain," and "What if it were your child?" Protesters aimed to put pressure on Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu to take the necessary measures to secure Shalit's freedom.
10 or 20,000 people here. We are all working for the same purpose, to make Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu to make the exchange of the Palestinian prisoners to bring Gilad Shalit back home.
Netanyahu has agreed to free 1,000 Palestinian prisoners in exchange for Shalit on the condition that they are not to return to the West Bank. The deal does not include what Netanyahu considers to be hardened terrorists. The German-mediated deal has been met with silence from Hamas. So far, Netanyahu has resisted calls to broker Shalit's release at any cost. The family and march participants will make their way this evening to Kerem Shalom, the site of Shalit's abduction. This is Ariel Reshef for IBA News.
Ambiguity still dominates the Iraqi political scene, specifically after the National Iraqi Alliance refused to renew the term of outgoing prime minister and leader of the State of Law Coalition, Nouri al-Maliki. The five main blocs of the National Iraqi Alliance, headed by the Supreme Islamic Council that is led by Ammar al-Hakim, sent al-Maliki a message to inform him of its refusal to renew his term after the talks between the two sides over the formation of the next government were halted. This political development, which alters the dynamics, coincided with the end of American Vice President Joseph Biden's visit to Iraq that lasted 3 days. During the visit, he tried to resolve the crisis in the formation of the government before the end of the constitutional deadline in the middle of July. Biden proposed a number of options that remained undisclosed, but they could be similar to the message he delivered to Nouri al-Maliki, in which he invited him to ally with Iyad Alawi in order to put an end to sectarianism and get rid of foreign interferences. From Baghdad, our correspondent Shafiq Abdeljabbar.
A third day passes on Biden's visit to Iraq, and with him the meetings continue. And a new effort to end the deadlock in the country as the approaching constitutional deadline comes in the middle of July. He separately met with the leaders of the National Iraqi Alliance and Jalal Talabani.
The important matters we discussed include the current Iraqi situation and how to end the deadlock. In addition to reinforcing the American-Iraqi relations after withdrawal of American forces from Iraq.
Everything else that concerns Iraq was also discussed by Biden during an earlier meeting with the competing parties for the presidency. One invitation was sent after the two separate meetings, which seems to have been the visit's main objective, an invitation to have Alawi and al-Maliki's coalition stand side by side under one banner.
I can't say that it has reached the stage of maturity because there are some disagreements over the project, but there is one important point in that al-Iraqiyya Syria holds on to its constitutional right to form the government.
American pressure was intended, and a clear message signed by 35 senators from the U.S. Congress was delivered to al-Maliki, inviting him to rush the formation of a new government that is built on partnerships.
If we were to call this an intervention or American sponsorship, well, it is part of the security agreement. Americans, rather, the American administration, has to be present in order to form a government or form any Iraqi sovereignty or Iraqi positions. It cannot be done by force, but by choosing an Iraqi and having American oversight.
Iraqi politicians, even if optimistic in their statements, still need to specify their political paths and appear harmonious at least before the 14th of July, which is the last deadline for the end of the first session that was opened 1 month ago. From Baghdad, Shafiq Abdeljabbar, Dubai TV.
Many residents of the town of Tikrit, in the center of Salah al-Din governorate, are forced to buy bottled water for their daily consumption. This is because the water they receive through water pipes continues to be contaminated with impurities and dirt, with no sign indicating that it has been purified and sterilized.
As a result of the rising temperature, the potable water problem continues to deteriorate in the summer. Due to the bad condition that the water pipes are in, residents are forced to buy barrels of mineral water. Business for this locally bottled water boomed on the market, in the streets and shops, since people are afraid to drink tap water that seems to have impurities and dirt floating in it.
The water is supposed to be suitable to drink, but we bought these things because it's unsuitable to drink. We place these filters in here, and when you open the filter, you can see dirt and even insects in it.
Some people come and say that they want purified water that's clean to drink, so they don't get sick. We can't drink if it's dirty.
According to institutions responsible for water, the reason for the deterioration of the quality of tap water is the obsolescence of the water pipes that transport the water to the residential areas.
The water companies that they have established, whether the old ones or the new ones, in reality are not successfully executing the central water projects. Because these companies were, let's say, temporary, and it doesn't matter how much we try to clean and purify it, sometimes the citizens have to purify it again as well. Sometimes we purify it and it falls within the required standards, but you can see with the naked eye that it contains some impurities and dirt. However, even with these impurities, the water still falls within the required standards.
It is worth mentioning that from time to time, the Iraqi Ministry of Health releases the names of the workshops that do not comply with these health conditions, in addition to measuring and controlling the quality of the water. The quality of tap water here continues to be compromised due to the existence of unqualified workshops. Amer Al-Ajiri, Baghdad Satellite TV, Tikrit.
The governor of Kirkuk, Abdul Rahman Mustafa, led the widest range campaign aimed at eliminating violations on public property. The governor of Kirkuk and a number of general managers in the public service sector participated in the campaign. The campaign started at the entrance of Suleiman Road and Khawli Road in Kirkuk and headed west towards Erbil. It encompassed the removal of violations on parking lots, agricultural and oil fields, and the municipality. The governor affirmed that moving forward with his campaign is in the public's interest. للصالح العام.
The family of martyr Haider Shaheen Dawood, martyred during the electricity intifada in Basra province, demanded that the Iraqi government open an investigation into the incident to find out who was responsible for it and try them in court. Dawood family also demanded that the government not take lightly the shedding of Iraqi blood. The family requested that the shopkeeper be declared a martyr in order for his four family members who were left behind to receive benefits, not to mention that he was also supporting his mother and sister.
A widow with three orphans in a closed store. These are the consequences of the death of Haider Shaheen Dawood. He died due to a stray bullet while he was participating in a demonstration with Basra residents who are demanding better public services, especially electricity. The lack of electricity has negatively affected the citizens' lives, mainly since the temperature has reached as high as 50 degrees Celsius. The citizens are outraged by untruthful promises made by Iraq officials, which were like drugs intended to numb people. The residents of Basra finally exploded with outrage and vented their anger against those who made false promises during the elections. The Iraqi people are now regretting having helped some Iraqi officials win in the elections.
What did these children do wrong? They keep crying and can't eat. They keep saying that they want their father. What else can I tell you, son? Should I tell you about his widow who faints all the time? Yesterday we took her to the hospital and she had to stay there until the evening. What can I tell you? I don't have the heart to talk to you.
They surprised the demonstrators with gunfire. Whoever is responsible for the gunfire, whether they are from the police, army or intelligence, is condemned, condemned and condemned. This is wrong. This is against God, Islam, humanity, and anyone who cares about the Iraqi people.
During the elections, they contacted us and gave us money and blankets. They were talking to us nicely and tried to explain to us their platforms. They promised us electricity and employment and said that they will turn Basra into paradise. They said that every child will have a home to live in and that they will help every person get a car and a job. Where are all these promises? The Palestinians are being killed and colonized by the Jews. I would like to know, are they also colonizing us? I want an answer.
This humble shop, which Haider opened to sell desserts as a means to make a living for his family and brothers, was shut down because there was no one to take Haider's place. In addition, all the ingredients supposed to be used to make dessert in the shop were actually used to make food for people who came to present their condolences.
Who will support his widow and family, and who will run his shop? Even the ingredients that he had to make desserts, we had to use to feed the people who came to present their condolences. We have nothing to help out. We were forced to take everything from the shop.
Everyone loved him. If they did not love him, they would not have come to present their condolences. If the people did not like him, they would not cry for him. He was only 27 years old. This does not please God.
The main provider passed away, leaving behind a widow and three orphans. He died while trying to voice his opposition to electricity shortages. He did not die in an explosion caused by a roadside bomb or a booby-trapped vehicle or even an explosive belt. Iraq's graves are full of people who died from these kind of explosions due to the lack of security and due to administrative corruption, which is what Iraq is now known for worldwide. Instead of cursing the forces of darkness, recite the Quranic verse of Al-Fatiha for all the martyrs who died trying to voice their opposition to Basra's electricity shortages.
Lebanon has declared a national day of mourning after the death of its top Shiite cleric, Sayyid Mohammed Hussein Fethullah. Thousands of people gathered in front of his mosque in the southern suburbs of Beirut to participate in the funeral.
Tens of thousands of mourners gathered in South Beirut to participate in the funeral of Lebanon's most eminent Shiite cleric, Ayatollah Mohammed Hussein Fethullah. Sayyid Fethullah was mainly known for his modern approach to Islam, but at the same time was also recognized as someone against the U.S.'s presence in the region. Overcome by the heat and their emotions, several people fainted and were treated on the spot by paramedics.
Literally thousands of people have gathered here in Beirut's southern suburbs to mourn the death of the Grand Ayatollah Mohammed Hussein Fethullah.
Lebanese officials, along with many representatives from regional countries, attended the funeral. Ayatollah Ahmad Jannati, a representative of Iran's supreme leader Ayatollah Ali Khamenei, a representative of Iranian President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, as well as Ali al-Adib, an aide to the Iraqi prime minister, attended the funeral, along with other prominent foreign officials.
Sayyid Fadlallah was not only a leader of the Shia community, but he was also a leader to all modern people, regardless of their faith. He was a man who believed that Lebanon and all Arab countries should have unity.
And tributes have been poured from many Islamic countries. The seminars in Najaf in Iraq, where the Ayatollah was born and studied, declared 3 days of mourning. The number of delegations who have come from outside Lebanon shows that Ayatollah Fadlallah's impact was well appreciated beyond Lebanese borders. We caught up with the Bahrainian King Hamad ibn Isa Al Khalifi's envoy, who told us this day is a day of sorrow for Bahrain as well.
The construction of the Grand Mosque in the French city of Marseille has sparked controversy over the integration of Muslim residents into French society. Some fear that the project will lead to an increase in tension that exists between Muslims and right-wingers in Marseille, which has the largest French Muslim community in the country.
For 150 years, the Basilica of Notre Dame has dominated the skyline of Marseille. On the horizon, it is a landmark, and for the fishermen, it is a lighthouse for their return to the port. This scene may change after the construction of another religious edifice belonging to a different faith, the Grand Mosque of Marseille, or the Basilica Mosque, as some would call it. The project will cost $60 million, and its planners say its architecture is inspired by the Taj Mahal. The minaret will rise 80 feet, and the prayer room will have the capacity to hold about 70,000 worshippers. It is a paradox that the location that was chosen for building this mosque was a pork shop not too long ago. Some think of this choice as some kind of conspiracy, while others think that this location is ideal.
We need a large place because this is a big project.
Regardless of the location, Muslims, who have dreamt about this mosque since 1936, are looking forward for their dream to come true. But a number of French people see the mosque as a source of concern. The building will become a dominant feature of the city and a visible sign of Islam's flourishing.
We hope that the Muslims practice their religion with discretion because they are in a society with solid Christian traditions. They should respect us just as we respect them and their countries.
From the Muslims' point of view, the construction of the new mosque is considered to be an endorsement of their integration. For others, it is another source of a major conflict that is brewing in French society.
The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible from support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online, stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows and more at linktv.org/mosaic.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.